Hello and welcome to another tutorial video. Today I'm going to talk about how to adjust or calibrate your panoramic tripod head. In the last videos, or in the earlier videos, I showed you that you don't necessarily need a tripod. You can use the string technique, but sometimes it is useful to use a tripod. But if you do use a tripod, you absolutely have to use a panoramic tripod head. Otherwise, there's no point, because what you want to do is you always want to rotate your camera about the no-parallax point of the lens. So, where do we begin? Well, I've started to assemble this Nodal Ninja 3 in this case, and that most of the panoramic tripod heads come with a base plate that you install on the base of the camera, and then that you hook that into the tripod head. Now, when you install the base plate, you want to make sure you always install it in the same way. For instance, here from the Nodal Ninja 3, that base plate has a little lip at the front, and at some stage I decided that I always have the lip at the front, and this is how I always install it, because the plate is not symmetrical. Another thing you want to look out for is that the base plate is really installed parallel, absolutely parallel to the camera, as good as you can. Now, once you've installed that, you can bring that into the camera. The next step is going to be to adjust that vertical arm along the horizontal axis. What you want to do is get the camera centered exactly above that rotation axis. Now, if you have a camera which has a live view feature, this is very straightforward, because what you do is you just rotate the camera vertically down like that, and you should see this in the little inset now. And the next thing, you would turn on the live view, zoom all the way in on the live view, and then all you want to make sure is that this point here in the middle is in the middle of your image. If you don't have the live view, what you do is you just slide the arm back and forth. Make sure you tighten it in, because as you can see, as I tighten it, it changes a little bit as I tighten the screw. Make sure you always do it with the screw tightened. You take an image, you zoom all the way in, and then again you look whether it's aligned or not, and you shift it accordingly. So in this case, I've installed the stopper there so that I can find that point really quickly when I reassemble it. But you also would want to write down the numbers, because sometimes you change the stopper, or if you have a different camera which has different settings, you'd need to change that as well. So make sure you install the stopper and you also write down the values. Now, once I've done that, the next thing, and this is the much more time-consuming part, is going to be adjusting the no-parallax point along the horizontal axis. And for that, I'm just going to bring the camera around. Okay, now the next step, as I said, is to adjust the camera along that vertical axis, moving back and forth. Another thing that I forgot to say earlier on is that you want to make sure that your tripod head has a little bubble level here, that the bubble level is centered, because otherwise, again, you get some funny off-axis effects. Now, in order to adjust the camera along the vertical rail, I have a little tool installed here, a highly scientific skewer stick, and I've aligned that with some big pointy object in the background, this beautiful clock tower down there. And what I will do now is I'll try to keep those two things, as I move the camera around, they want to be in the same line, because if I want to stitch those, if I were to stitch those images later on, I'd want the skewer relative to the clock tower in the exactly same position. And if you manage to adjust your camera correctly, or adjust the tripod head correctly, this will be, you can achieve this, and then it'll be very, very easy for the stitching software later on to put the images together. Now, there's another important thing, and it took me a little while to figure this one out, or to believe it, because I thought, wow, it can't be that big an effect. It is a big effect. Namely, the nodal point of the lens shifts back and forth as you go off to the side of the optical axis of the lens. Now, this makes a big difference, because it depends on where you're going to stitch your images. This is an 8mm fisheye lens on a crop camera, so that means I will be taking four images around, so 90 degrees apart. So that means, for the lens, the images will be overlapping, the two images together will be overlapping at the 45 degree mark, so 45 to the left and 45 to the right of the center of the lens. So it's at that point, 45 degrees to the left and to the right, that's why I want to get the parallax absolutely perfect. So some people adjust their lens where they go to the very extreme side of the lens. You don't want to do this. You want to put it at 45 degrees left, 45 degrees right. Now, if this was, say, a 15mm fisheye lens or a 12mm fisheye lens, whatever, and you'd need six images around the horizontal axis, you would have to take your images 60 degrees apart. In that case, you want to reduce the parallax at 30 degrees to the left and to the right. So in this case, I will be turning the camera. This is the zero position now, and I will be turning the camera 45 degrees in one direction, back to neutral, and 45 degrees in the other direction. Now, look very closely at the skewer relative to the church tower. What I will do is, I will bring the camera all the way back on the rail. So that means the rail, the camera is too far, it's behind the nodal point. And now look closely how the skewer, so the close object, is moving relative to the far object. You can see it is moving in the same direction as I rotate. So now I'm rotating the camera this way, and you will see the close object, the skewer, shift in the same direction. Right? So it's shifting in the same direction as I'm rotating. So that happens when you're too far back relative to the nodal point. And the same if I go all the way to the front, this is, I'm beyond the nodal point, so I'm further than the, I'm too close to the object, so in front of the nodal point relative to the rotation axis. In that case, again, look closely what's happening to the skewer, and you can see that it is moving in, I think I'm right in the nodal point here. I can't go any closer, but what you would see if you're beyond the nodal point, you would see that the close object is going to move in the opposite direction as I'm turning. And I came up with this really great way of remembering this. So if the close object, we're always talking about the close object, if the close object is moving in the opposite direction relative to the background object and how you're turning, so opposite, then you want to move outwards, right? OMO. If it's moving opposite, move outwards. Now, this is getting really hard to judge on the display, on the back here of my camera display. So what you would do next is you would take photos and then zoom all the way in and compare them. Okay, so I will turn off the video on this stream and I'll start taking still shots and then zoom all the way in. Okay, so I'll turn all the way to the left, 45 degrees down here, take an image, rotate 45 degrees in the other direction, take an image. Now, what I'll do is I will zoom all the way in. I'll show you this on the screen in the video, but now I have the right image, right of the clock tower, and the skewer is in a certain position relative to the clock tower. Now I will switch to the previous image, so the church tower is now all the way on the right. And again, zoomed all the way in, I judge what happened. So as I turned the camera left, you notice that the skewer moved over to the right. So that's opposite, right? The skewer moved in the opposite direction as I moved the camera. So in that case, I have to go outwards a little bit. So we'll do the same exercise. Now we'll take an image. I'll go back to the initial position on the left. Take one to the left of the tower, 90 degrees, and one to the right of the tower. Again, I zoom all the way into the image. To look closely here now. So now we're again to the right of the tower, and the skewer is in a certain position there. I'm switching over to the previous image. I've moved the camera to the left. And again, having moved left, the skewer appears to have moved to the right. Again, opposite, so I need to go outwards. So I move back a little bit further. Again, same trick. Take one image to the left, 90 degrees to the right. Zoom all the way in. On my previous screen back here. Now I notice the skewer now is aligned almost with the side of the clock tower. I now rotate the camera towards the left. And what happened to the clock tower? I'm scrolling around here. Aha! So the skewer has moved to the left as well. That means I am, so opposite, you have to move out. But if it's moving in the same direction as the camera turned, I have to move inwards a little bit. There we go, a little bit more. Same exercise again. I turn to the left, take one image, rotate over, take a second one, zoom all the way in. on the preview screen back here. Look, okay, there's a tiny little bit of the clock tower just to the right of the skewer. Now I'm looking to the next image, having virtually turned my camera towards the left. What happened to the skewer? And the skewer, well, it's almost there. Okay, I'll leave it at that. You get the idea. Just remember, if the close object is moving in opposite directions as you're turning the camera, then you want to move outward. So with this back and forth, you start to find that point, and once you've aligned it perfectly, again, don't forget to bring the stopper up to your lens, up to the position that you have the camera in now. And then you also want to take note, or even take a photo with your cell phone of the marking where you have your camera. And at that point, you have found your nodal point and you're done. So thank you very much for your attention. Please do visit my website, pano.ie, and shoot me an email if you have any questions. All right, bye.